Amen. Good morning, church. We're here, we're talking, we're glad to be together in person and at home. So praise be to God that we can be the church on Sunday morning to worship and celebrate our faith. And I'm David Husseltine, pastor of this congregation, so it's good to be together. And a couple announcements I want to share. One is, as you'll be seeing during the service, I'll be the lone participant in actually speaking. Chancellor's going to be leading worship through the music. But we're still looking for lay readers who would like to help out. I know there's a couple of you who said you're willing to do that. And we'll be starting next week with a schedule for those that like to lay read. So again, think about it, pray about it. And if you're interested in helping us out by being a liturgist, let me know at the church office. And we can talk more about what that involves and get you on a schedule. The other announcement is this coming Saturday at 1 o'clock, we'll gather in the sanctuary for a celebration of the life of Dr. Reverend Richard Dick Cheatham. So Dick was a pastor here for 12 years. It was a while ago, but a lot of fond memories that folks have of Dick. And that celebration will be at 1 o'clock, followed by a little reception in Cyril's Hall. Though we would like to know how many to plan for, so if you are planning on attending, please contact Carol Bridgeford so she can have an idea how many to prepare for. So this coming Saturday, even though Dick passed away in 2019, we are finally getting a chance here in Michigan anyway to celebrate his life. And there's some other announcements in your bulletin that which you do have now for those here and for those at home. We send an electronic bulletin, and we always encourage you to read through that so you'll know what's happening in the life of our church as well as see the prayer concerns. But now I invite us to stand, if we're able, to join in our call to worship. Your steadfast love, O God, extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the skies. Your righteousness is like the mountains, your wisdom as deep as the sea. How precious is your faithfulness to us, O God. All may come to take refuge in the shadow of your wings. So come, let us worship God, and now we sing together When Morning Gilds the Skies. We prepare ourselves for a time of prayer. And before we sing the hymn of meditation, just a couple things to lift up. I got word yesterday from Steve Jonas that his wife Connie passed away last week in California. Her son's a doctor, and actually she's been out in California for the last year and a half, struggling with health concerns and never made it back to Michigan. But her husband Steve, who is Catholic, but he used to worship with Connie here, was out in California when she passed away. So the plans are to bury her in West Virginia, but then to have some sort of service here in the sanctuary. Connie was Filipino, and there's a community of Filipinos that they'll be organizing some sort of celebration of her life here, and we'll let you know when that takes place. The other announcement, I know Carol Bridgeford has a bunch of ladies that communicate every day with prayer concerns and little devotionals, and she passed along a desire to encourage the ladies to send cards to Vicki Hurd. And she's a longtime member, and that was her ministry, to send cards to people in our church. Well, her birthday is tomorrow, so July the 12th. So the encouragement is to send cards to Vicki. And she's at the Villas of Green Lake Estate, and that's up in Orchard Lake. And we have the address if you're interested. So I know the ladies are sending cards, but the rest of us, it would be a neat gesture just to send her a card. And through this coming week and a half, as she's receiving cards, that will be a blessing to her. So just something to think about and pray about. And if you can, I know Vicki would really appreciate that. And those are the concerns that I have, and there's also the prayer concerns that are in our bulletin that we can look over. But we join our hearts together in prayer, and to prepare ourselves, let's sing, I Need Thee Every Hour, verse 2. Gracious God, we come before you today and every day with gratitude upon our hearts. You have blessed us in so many ways. We have homes to live in, we have clothes to wear, we have food to eat. And though we may take these things for granted, there are those that are near us and far away from us that struggle with these basic necessities of life. So just as we are mindful of how fortunate we are aware of those in need, and we pray for their well-being. May those with influence make decisions that help and protect the least among us. And this morning we awoke to the sound of gentle rainfall. We thank you for the nourishment of water. And just as rain falls freely upon us, so does your love. Unfortunately, Lord, a couple weeks ago we received too much rain, and folks in Metro Detroit continue to work to recover from all the flooding. We pray for those that lost personal belongings that are still cleaning and disinfecting. May they receive the physical and financial help they need as they go forward. And finally, O Lord, we lift up our church family. Though we've not been able to be all together, we still feel the connection we have with others through Christ, and we do pray for one another. And this morning, as we heard the news, we thank you for Connie Jonas. And we thank you for her life, and we mourn with Steve her passing. And may your comforting arms bring peace to all those that mourn. And also, Lord, today we lift up Vicki Hurd and Dave Roberts and Tom Bridgeford as they continue to struggle with their health concerns. May health and your assurance come to them. And there's others, O Lord, we know that are struggling with mental or physical health, with relationships or finances. So now, O Lord, as we end this time of prayer, we take some silent meditation time where in our own way we can lift up those things we bring with us, especially the concerns that we have for friends, for family, maybe coworkers. So we enter this time of silent meditation bringing to you those things that weigh heavy on our hearts and our minds. And now we join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, this morning, every morning, we have opportunities in our worship to make an offering, and we used to have ushers come by with the plates, but we no longer do that. But we have plates here available in the entranceways, and for those at home watching, we do encourage you to send an offering either through the mail or electronically through our webpage. And just a note, I mentioned our prayers, the flooding that we know we had in Metro Detroit and Dearborn and other areas in this place, and we have a national committee, United Methodist Committee on Relief, UMCOR, and they send response teams and monies to natural disasters. And we think about hurricanes and floods and earthquakes. Well, UMCOR has been sending help to Detroit these last few weeks, sending flood buckets and other sources of help and assistance. So that's one way that we are connected as United Methodist Church. And if we give to UMCOR, special giving, that some of that has come back to Detroit. So we're thankful for that, but if it's on your hearts to help out, you can write a check to the church and make it out to UMCOR on your memo, and we'll make sure that gets to those folks that continue to supply help for those recovering from the floods. But let us pray as we ask God's blessings upon the offerings that we give. So gracious Lord, we are blessed in many ways, and in response, we have an opportunity to give just a portion back to you through the church. And we pray, O Lord, that you'll bless these gifts as they're used in the ministry of this church and beyond to continue your work. So these prayers, O Lord, we share to you in Christ's name. Amen. And now let's stand together and sing Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise
Thank you, Chancellor. Our scriptural lesson today comes from the Gospel of John, the 21st chapter, verses 1 through 6. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, and Nathanael of Cana of Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I'm going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, have you no fish, have you?" And they answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. May God add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and understanding of Holy Scripture. Thanks be to God. And I invite us to pause in a moment of prayer. And now, O Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, this morning is the last Sunday of my Watertail Summer Sermon Series. If you've joined us this last month or so, you know that I've been looking at stories that we find in the Bible that take place either near or on water. And I figure since many of us like to spend some of summer either on or near water, why not do that on Sunday mornings? And one of those activities that folks like to do on or near water is fish. And a couple weeks ago, I preached on fishing. You might recall, we looked at Jesus and the commission to go and be fishers of men and women, and how we learn some techniques from fishing that would help us fulfill that great commission. And if you look at my sermon titled today, A Fishing Story Part 2, you'll expect that today we'll be talking again about fishing. Now I confess, I am not a fisherman. I've fished a couple times and it's just not my thing, but I find it interesting talking to those people that are fishermen, that they're just as passionate about that sport as I am about my sport, and that is golf. And actually, just as there's golf tournaments, there's fishing tournaments. There's a whole circuit on bass fishing. In fact, if you go online and Google bass fishing, you'll see these pictures of all these anglers catching their bass. And it's interesting, as I've Googled this sport of bass fishing, that you can make a pretty good living. That the yearly earnings of a really decent bass fisherman is between $200,000 and $300,000. So not bad just for catching some fish. But not only on the professional level, I bet you didn't know that in the college level, there's bass fishing teams. In fact, on the screen, that is the boat and the truck that belongs to Adrian College for their bass fishing team. Pretty sporty, eh? Pretty fancy. And they actually get scholarships, right, to go to school and catch fish. In fact, my daughter, when she was at Central Michigan, one of her roommates was on the fishing team for Central. They weren't at the level of Adrian, but still, they had a fishing team. Now, way before there were scholarships or prize money, people made a living catching and selling fish. In fact, that's exactly what four of the disciples did before Jesus came into their life and followed him. That James and John, Simon and Andrew, along with eight others, traveled along Jerusalem and Israel and Samaria to be with Jesus. And they listened to him teach. They saw Jesus heal the sick. They witnessed some incredible things. And these disciples, they believed that Jesus was the long-awaited Messiah. And they were excited. They were part of this new thing, this bringing on the kingdom of God. But as we know, then everything changed. Jesus was arrested. He was executed via crucifixion. And he was put into a tomb. But we know the story, just like he predicted, Jesus rose from the dead, and the disciples, they saw Jesus, they talked to Jesus, they touched Jesus. This was an exciting time for those disciples, but I also believe it had to be a confusing time. That it was miraculous that their Savior lives, but what about this movement that they've been a part of? What did the future hold for them? So friends, that's the background of our scripture lesson today. The disciples were just sitting around. They were probably in awe of this resurrection, but also uncertain about what was going to come next. So you can picture the scene. There they are, just sitting together, and then Simon stands up, and he says, "I'm going fishing." Now, I've read different commentaries on this section of John's Gospel. One suggests that Peter had decided then and there to go back to the family business. For that's what he did before Jesus came along, right? He was a fisherman. And he figured that this movement, whatever it was, has come to an end. Jesus is no longer with them. So he needed to get back to some normalcy. He needed to go back to the family business and be that fisherman. He thought, you know, that was a good 3-year run. That was fun, right? But now it's time to get back to reality, go back to fishing. Now, that's just one perspective, right, on what Peter decided to do. Other commentaries suggest that Peter, he wasn't giving up on this thing Jesus had started, that Peter believed that there was probably something next, but he just didn't know what that was. And he felt it might be good to stop sitting around. He had to do something, so go back and do something he knew how to do, and that was fish. That would be good for him physically and emotionally to go back and do something normal, to go back out on the boat. And it must have sounded like a good idea, right? Because the other disciples said, "Yes, we will go with you." And as we continue reading in our story, we'll see that the disciples, after being in the boat all night long, they came in empty-handed. No fish to be caught, tired, weary. And they see a stranger on the shoreline. He yells out, "Hey, did you catch any fish?" And can you imagine the disciples? They were probably tired again. They were frustrated. And here the stranger was reminding them of their emptiness, of their no catch. But then the stranger says, "Hey, why don't you cast the nets on the other side of the boat?" And they did it. And they caught more fish than they could bring into the boat. And that's when they realized that this was Jesus. Now, as I mentioned earlier in our sermon series, one of the focuses I had is look at our call to be disciples of Christ and to make more disciples, to be fishers of men and women. So for that sermon series, one of the pictures we used was of this modern-day fisherman that Diana took a picture of when she was in Israel, showing people on the boat how they would cast the nets to catch fish in the Sea of Galilee. So let's use this picture again to remind us of our disciples, as us disciples, and the suggestion of Jesus to make disciples of Christ. And how on that day by the Sea of Galilee, Jesus suggested to them to cast that net on the other side of the boat. So as we, you and I, seek to identify with the disciples and see what lessons we can learn from Jesus, one of the lessons we can learn from this story is about evangelism, right? That this action of trying something different, to putting that net on the other side of the boat, maybe that might be illustrative to us, that the techniques that we're using to reach disciples, to catch fish, if they're not working, why don't we try something new, something different? Now, that's a helpful lesson. But this morning, my preaching isn't on evangelism. I like us to put ourselves in the story on the other side of the picture. That instead of this being a lesson on evangelism, I like us to see this story, to see what we can find on a very personal level, and what we can do to grow spiritually, right? To grow more connected to Christ. So I like us to take on that perspective, that I believe that Peter's decision to go back to fishing is helpful for us as we will try to grow in our faith. So let me tell you what I mean by that. So go back to the disciples. They left their nets approximately 3 years earlier. And as these disciples traveled with Jesus, they saw amazing things, right? They had many exciting, emotionally stimulating times with Jesus. They saw people's lives change. They saw numerous people healed at the hand of Jesus. They witnessed Jesus doing miraculous things. You couldn't explain how it happened. He took a few fish, right, a few loaves of bread, and he served thousands of people. Storms were calmed just by Jesus saying a few words. And at the very end, finally, they experienced the resurrected Christ. These were amazing experiences. These were mountaintop experiences. And friends, I believe as believers, we too will have mountaintop experiences. Maybe not like the disciples. We're not going to see anybody walking on water. We're not going to see anybody calming the storms. Well, you'll still see amazing things and experience amazing things, these mountaintop experiences that we'll have that will be exciting, emotionally stimulating. One of those ways could be in worship. Maybe we're part of worship here, maybe one of our cantatas. There's a picture on the screen, the choir, they do these wonderful cantatas. Maybe we're caught up in the rapture, right? In one of those worship experiences, a mountaintop experience. Or maybe it might be out in nature. We're out there, we're caught in the wonder of God's environment. So we have a picture there, we used to use it in one of our screens. That's a picture of Diana Gowdy, our PowerPoint person. And she finally got to see this waterfall that she had been wanting to see for years. And when she was there, she was so caught up, she couldn't help but to raise her arms, right? And say, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Oh God, how great thou art." So maybe you and I, when we're out in nature, we're caught up, right, in the wonder, the majesty of creation, and that's a mountaintop experience. We can't believe it. This is wonderful. And we grow in our faith. Or it might be while serving. We might be down at CAS serving a lunch and just feeling that connection, right, with these hungry folks that are less fortunate than us, maybe in that experience. Or maybe it's putting together those meal kits that we've been doing recently. Maybe just doing that gives us this energy, this passion, this high. And this is a mountaintop experience. So these are important, and they deepen our faith. But guess what, friends? They're not regular occurrences. That we're not on the mountaintop very often. That most of our lives are spent in mundane moments of day-to-day living. And that's more what it's like for those disciples who are mentioned in our scripture today. Here they were back in Galilee with nothing to do. There was no resurrected Christ talking to them. So what was there to do? Well, Peter decided to do this ordinary thing. To go fishing on the Sea of Galilee. Why not go fishing? It's an ordinary thing. That's maybe the right thing for us to do. So why not go fishing? Well, friends, it's like us on an ordinary day. Suppose it's not Sunday and there's no worship service to attend. What do we do in normal days? Well, we go to work, we care for our families, we keep our house, we spend time with friends, we relax, we play. Week after week, we do normal things, ordinary things. So this is our ordinary life. Now, after going through a very unusual year with this pandemic, I think going back to some normalcy feels good, right? It feels good. And I think the story about Peter, he just went through 3 years of an unordinary life. He saw miraculous things. He experienced some high times, but also some turmoil, some difficulty. So after all this strange, unusual time with Jesus, he probably felt it was good to get back to some normalcy there on the boat. But there was another surprise for Peter, that even in this normal activity, it could lead to an experience of God's presence that would help them grow in this faith. And that's what I want for us to realize, that even in our normal activities, day-to-day activities, that you and I can experience Christ. It doesn't have to be on the mountaintop. We can experience Christ even in the day-to-day activities of our lives. We just have to be open and aware of God's presence. Now, this presence of God is illustrated by a reading of a story found in the Old Testament. In 1 Kings, there's a story about the prophet Elijah. And God tells Elijah to go to a mountain. So he goes to the mountain. And on that mountain, there's a mighty windstorm. But God wasn't in the windstorm. There was a terrible earthquake. But God wasn't in the earthquake. And there was an amazing fire, but God was not in the fire. But then there was a sound of a gentle whisper, and that's where Elijah heard God's voice. in that gentle whisper. And I think that tells us that, again, if we're open and aware of God's presence around us, that we will experience it. It's like the message that's on this rock, found from Psalm 46. Be still and know that I am God. The author of the Psalms realized what Elijah found out, that on that mountain, that to be still, to be quiet, that's when we're most receptive to hear that quiet voice of Jesus. Now think about those disciples on the boat. I bet you Jesus was yelling to those disciples out on the boat, but because of the distance and because they were tired, their weary ears, they probably were not hearing Jesus' voice very loudly. It probably came across very softly to them on the boat. And they're stretching, leaning. What's he saying? Catching a fish? What? Cast your net on the other side? Well, why not? Let's do it. So they did it, and to their surprise, they couldn't believe their eyes. For 1 minute, the net was empty. The next, it was full. So it was a normal day, and they were doing what they had done for a long time, but suddenly they were in the presence of the risen Jesus. And you might say that their normal time had some AARPJ. AARP, you know what that means, right? For those over 55, most of us here, we know what AARP. So, yeah, you join the club and you get discounts. But this club, this AARPJ, is available to everyone. There's no age limit. For this stands for added awareness of the risen presence of Jesus. That's what happened to those disciples on the Sea of Galilee. They became aware of Jesus' presence. That no matter where we are, the normal with AARP, added awareness of the risen presence of Christ, is offered to us every day. So friends, to be aware of that, again, we just need to be open to listen for that gentle voice. It could be at work. It could be at worship. It could be while we're relaxing. It could be while we're playing. Now, one practice I think that can help us to be aware of this presence of Jesus is to begin each day with a time of a devotion. It doesn't have to be very long, just a few moments, but a few moments every morning to spend time with God. Now, earlier you saw that rock on the screen. Well, that rock was given to Bob Gowdy when he retired from Royal Oak First Methodist Church after serving as a visitation pastor for over 10 years. Well, Diana has a nice little space in her offer deck, and has the rock on top of a waterfall. And behind the waterfall is a lily. Actually, that lily she took home from Easter a year ago. And surrounded by that lily is a bunch of other plants she has in patience. And there's a big green plant in her garden that actually Lucy Sapal gave to the Gowdies a couple years ago. And besides the plants, you can see there's statues of angels and painted bricks that her grandchildren made for her. So it's a beautiful spot that the Gowdies can go every morning and be quiet and be still and listen for that word of God. Now, we may not be fortunate to have a nice little quiet garden like the Gowdies have, but I encourage us to develop a spot, outdoors, indoors, just a place, a special place in our environment that we can go to in the morning or in the evening, and just to be still and to expect to hear the presence of Christ, the AARPJ. And when we do that every morning, you'll find it amazing that if you spend time thinking and praying to God in the morning, that presence of God will be with you the whole rest of the day. It's like an antenna has been raised. And you pick up those quiet sound waves, right, that alerts us to the evidence of God all around us. So that AARPJ, it tunes us in and makes us aware of those things that God's doing with us and around us. It's sort of like if you're ever looking for a new car to buy. Say you're looking maybe like a Ford Escape, and you're considering purchasing that car, but as you're driving around the neighborhood, as you're on your freeway, guess what? You're going to see every Ford Escape that's out there. You're going to be amazed. Wow, I didn't realize there's that many of those cars out there. They were always there all along, but what made you aware of them? You were thinking about them, right? You had your antenna up, and that's what happens with God. If you start thinking and praying to God in the morning, you'll be aware, right, of His presence. So friends, this summer, as we do our normal activities, whether it's gardening, it's grilling, it's swimming, or it's fishing, may we feel the presence of God. So let's begin the day thanking God for this new day, and thank God that we're getting back an opportunity to have some more normalcy in our lives, and we look for opportunities to serve and see God. So when we start tuning in to the added awareness of the risen presence of Jesus, we will be blessed by his presence and be amazed at the connection that we have with our Savior. Let us pray. Oh, gracious Lord, we're not out on the ship catching fish, but we're in worship here, we're at our homes eating, we're at restaurants, we're in our garden, we're at work, wherever our lives take us. And that, yes, God is on the mountaintop, that we can experience God in those amazing events in our lives, but God is also with us always, even in the everyday, even in the mundane. And if we start our day with the prayer and awareness of God's presence, we'll see evidences of God throughout our day. So help us in our journey, O Lord. Amen. And now, friends, I invite us to stand, if we're able, to sing our closing hymn, which is The Cry of My Heart. Just a word on your way out. We have just a couple gifts that we had given out for Mother's Day and Father's Day. So they're on the black table. There's one pen for a mother and two little pocket knives for a couple men. So if you didn't pick one up during those special days, please pick one up on the way out. But friends, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the love and knowledge of God and of his Son, Jesus the Christ. And may the grace of God Almighty be with us and sustain us this day and every single day. Amen.